Friends, good morning and welcome once more to our virtual worship service, our last one of 2020, and we are glad that you can join us as you worship from home. We have just a couple of announcements this morning. First of all, we will still be worshiping in this way virtually in January. We'll take things month by month moving forward in 2021. But as long as many people still have the virus as they do right now, we're going to try to be as cautious as possible. So in January, at least, we'll see what happens with the schools and what things happen in the communities around us. But we'll be worshiping virtually in January. Also, if you did not see it yet, we do have a Christmas Eve service on the website. So you can check out the website to see that. And they also recorded the singing of Silent Night at 7 o'clock in the parking lot. So you can look at that as well if you haven't had a chance to see those yet. That's all the announcements that I have for this morning. So once more, thank you for joining with us. We're going to begin this morning with a video that Ken has sent in. Ken sent in a video of him playing a song for our prelude this morning as we're still in the season of Christmas. So here's Ken Conklin playing for us. Amen. Thank you, Ken. And now From the Ground is going to bring our opening worship song to us, a song that reminds us to take the good news of Christmas and go tell it on the mountain.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Amen. Would you please pray with me? Lord God, it may seem like we are not able to get up on a mountain right now and shout the good news of Christmas. It seems like we're in our homes and we're not getting out very much. But we know, Lord, that we all have ways to proclaim the good news of Jesus being born and all that that means. So we pray, Lord, however we can, we'll tell it on our mountain. We'll tell others that Jesus is born, that he lives, and that he lives in us. We pray you bless every heart now as they listen to this morning's worship service. And even though we're in our homes, may we be filled by your Spirit. And let that Spirit flow forth from us into this world that needs your love. Amen. Friends, as you know, even though we are here, we don't have kids here with us, I'm still trying to do a children's message. Hopefully that the adults can get something out of as well. So if you've got kids at home and they want to listen for a minute, I'm going to talk a minute this morning about how we just had a song called Go Tell It on the Mountain, telling us that we need to tell everyone the good news of Christmas. But for a long time, it was illegal for people to be able to share their faith and spread their faith. And so Christians came up with ways to try to hidden symbols, a way to surprise people and teach people in hidden ways about the Christian faith. And one of those is another song. It's the 12 Days of Christmas, and it's one that kids sing a lot, of course. It can become annoying maybe to adults when you hear it over and over again at Christmas, but you might not know the story behind the song. First of all, there are 12 days in Christmas. Christmas is not just one day. Christmas is 12 days long. It begins on December 25th, and it ends on January 5th at the time of the Epiphany when the wise men saw the star in the sky. Now, the symbols in that song actually tell the story, many of the stories of the Christian faith. For example, the partridge on the first day of Christmas. The partridge represents Jesus because the partridge is the only bird that will die to protect its young. And so that's why the partridge was chosen as that symbol of Jesus. Two calling birds, for example, represent the Old and the New Testament. They call us, they tell us the faith, both books of both testaments in the Bible. Some of them, though, are more hidden, but you can understand when someone explains it to you. For example, six geese a-laying. Six geese a-laying is about creating new life when they're laying eggs. And in Genesis, creation took place in 6 days. On the seventh day, God rested. So it's about creation. That's why there's six geese a-laying. Others are a little bit more in-depth, like eight maids a-milking. Eight maids a-milking is one of the most humble jobs that there was. And these represent the eight beatitudes, the eight maids a-milking. The eight beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the meek, those who mourn, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, the merciful, the pure in heart, the peacemakers, and those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness. There are eight beatitudes. There's eight maids of milking. So those things aren't accidents. It's ways that people had to try to teach the Christian faith to others at a time when they weren't allowed to spread the faith. So when you hear that song, it seems like a silly song, but it actually was meant to teach people about Jesus and about our faith. The thing is, today, we don't have to have hidden ways to teach people about Jesus because we live in a place and in a time and we are free to share our faith. So what I want us to think about is if there used to be a time when people couldn't do that and they could get in real trouble if they did, but they did it anyways, then certainly we who are free to do so should take every chance that we have to go tell it on the mountain, meaning to go tell everybody as best we can that Jesus was born and that Jesus lives in us and can live in them. Amen. Let's say a little prayer together. Dear God, we thank you for even what seem like silly songs, like the 12 Days of Christmas, that teach us about your faith, about what you've done through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray, Lord, that we would be people who would share our faith with others. Maybe we're not going to actually climb up on a mountain, Lord, and sing a song, but that song just reminds us to tell everybody, everywhere we can, anytime we can, that you are alive and you live in us. And we pray that we'll do this not only at Christmas, but always. In your name we pray. Amen. Friends, I have a few joys and concerns to share with you, as always, this morning before we prepare our hearts for prayer. First of all, a couple of joys. Lenore Sirstead turned 100 years old yesterday. And I remember being with her when she was turning 99 and talking about how we would try to have a party after church today when she turned 100. And of course, that can't happen. So, but we want to wish her a happy birthday if you're watching, Lenore. And Debbie did send out an email that you can send a card to her if you would like to wish her a happy 100th birthday. Also, Nancy Hoy is home, and she was able to be with her family at Christmas. And so we praise God for that and ask his continued healing upon Nancy. My own father, Richard Darren, has shown no symptoms still of COVID, so they don't know if he had a false test result, which happens sometimes, as you know, or if he's just doing well with the virus. So either way, I'm happy about that. Some other people then that need our prayers. Betty Allen fell again and broke her wrist and ankle while she was in Tennessee at her daughter's house. So Betty will be in Tennessee now for some time. Betty's had several things like this happen lately, so please keep Betty in your prayers. A number of people have been diagnosed with COVID. Tom and Carol Orwig, and Tom is in the hospital right now, so please keep them in your prayers. Ron Newcomb is Mary Namath's son. He has COVID. Dale and Patty Likens have COVID. Paul Raimondo has serious complications from COVID, so please keep Paul in your prayers as well. And then Wendy McDonald is recovering from surgery. Charlene Boomhauer still needs our prayers. Bob Gribling is undergoing treatments for his non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Nancy Miggs is still with Healthcare Solutions. Please keep her in prayer. Continue to pray for Dave Gibbs, Georgia Stefani, Dale Gephardt, Jim and Ruby Piper, and John Schuliger. And this morning in the paper, two former members of Warren First have passed away, Kale Moran and Jay Lacey. So please keep those families in your prayers. And finally, Ammon Rowe's dad took a fall. He lives in Virginia, and he had some bleeding on the brain, but they're hoping that that will simply reabsorb. He is doing a little better now. He is in rehab, and his name is Ed Fry, in a rehab center in Virginia. So please keep Ann Monroe's dad, Ed Fry, in your prayers as well. Friends, as we prepare our hearts for prayer this morning, I invite you to join together in a song that reminds us to rejoice at all times, even in a time like 2020 has been, even a time when we have so many people that need our prayers. We want to still rejoice. And so this song is called Good Christian Friends Rejoice. Friends, would you please join with me for a moment of silent prayer as we come to our God together in prayer today. Lord God, we give you thanks that today we can rejoice. Even in the midst of everything that's happened during this long year, all the trials and struggles that we've had as a country and as a planet, even with so many people in our congregation that need your presence now in their life in some way, we can still rejoice. Because you were born to save. You were born to save us, Lord, from sin, from death, but from also the fear that we sometimes have in our hearts when we struggle with things, when we don't have control, when we worry about tomorrow, when we worry about what is going to happen. You're born to save us and to fill us with your Spirit, to give us your strength and hope, and even certainty in knowing that you are with us. You are within us. You are beside us. You are all around us. You wrap us in your loving arms each day. And we can rejoice in knowing that you love us in ways that go beyond our ability to understand. And so, Lord, as this year ends, still we rejoice. Help our hearts to be filled with joy. Help our hearts to be filled with your Spirit. And let that flow out from us into this world that needs it right now. Lord, we pray for all the people that we've mentioned this morning. Continue to pray for Nancy Hoy, for Betty Allen, for Tom and Carol Orwig, Ron Newcomb, Paul Raimondo, Dale and Patty Likens, Kate Dunlap, Lord, who has health issues now as well, for Charlene Boomhauer, Bob Gribling, Nancy Miggs, Dave Gibbs, Georgia Stefani, Dale Gephardt, Jim and Ruby Piper, John Schuliger, Moran and Lacey families, and for Ed Fry, and for anyone else, Lord, whom we name in our hearts before you this morning at home. Anyone, anywhere who needs the touch of your healing hand or the strength and comfort of your Holy Spirit or simply needs your presence, your hope, your joy that you can give each person. Lord, we pray you would touch each person and be with them in a powerful and mighty way. And we pray, as always, Lord, that wherever it is possible, you would use us and take us to be your hands and feet, to be a source of encouragement or hope with the words that we say or the actions that we do. Lord, we pray that somehow we would show your light, your love, your hope to those who need it as this year ends and a new one begins. And Lord, as this new year begins, we ask your blessing upon it. We pray, Lord, that we would each be able to look forward to the future, knowing that you will be with us as you've been with us this year and in ages past. And so, Lord, as we look to this new year, fill us again with hope and the certainty in knowing that you are with us no matter what happens in this new year. And we pray all these things together this morning in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we prepare to hear God's word this morning, Clay has another song for us. It's Away in a Manger.
The stars in the sky look down.
Amen. I'll be reading the scripture towards the end of the message this morning. So I ask if you would please take a moment to pray with me and for me. O Lord, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I always enjoy a New Year's celebration. I've never felt the need to stand in the freezing cold in New York City and fight the crowds to watch the ball drop. I'm content to watch it on TV, but there's a sense of excitement and celebration that a new year can bring. And it's possible people are looking forward to the calendar change from 2020 to 2021, unlike any year I can remember in my lifetime. The jokes about how horrible 2020 has been in so many ways are endless. And it's because so many bad things have happened in 2020. Of course, there's the virus, and there was racial strife and raging fires and so much else. But we also lost many beloved people in our own church family, and many others have had extended battles with illness. But there's an old saying that every cloud has a silver lining, meaning there's always something good to look for. There's another old saying, look on the bright side. It comes from the idea that half the earth is lit up from the sun. You can always look on the bright side, know the sun is shining somewhere. For example, those loved ones we've lost, we haven't really lost them. They're with God forevermore. And those who are still fighting illnesses are indeed fighting them with people loving and supporting them and praying for them. On Christmas Eve, we gathered people outside in the church parking lot to sing Silent Night. I had been praying for a little snow, which I thought would be beautiful. I think I prayed too hard. We got a lot of snow and wind, which made it all but impossible to keep candles lit. But some of us could use the lights on our cell phones, and we're still able to gather just to sing Silent Night. We overcame what was happening. A few weeks ago, I told you about the Christmas star, how rare it is, and how you should watch for it as a sign of hope. Then, of course, as 2020 goes, the visibility here was so poor it wasn't really possible to see it at its full conjunction. But it was elsewhere in our country and around the world. Jacob's going to show you now a picture that Scott Messina sent to me of the star out in Arizona. Picture that Scott took. He's out in Arizona. Scott Messina was able to take the picture of the star as he could see it. So in a way, it's almost fitting in 2020. It reminds us that although we can't always see God shining in the dark times, God is. And other people can see that light, and they can share it with us just as we can share it with others. Thank you, Jacob. With that in mind, I thought I would end what has been a hard year for so many by looking back on some of the positive things I noticed that happened in 2020, some of the ways God shined through people. These aren't going to be in any particular order, except I'll start with large-scale news and end with personal news. First of all, it's large-scale news that a record number of people voted in 2020 in the election. As you know, I'm neither Democrat nor Republican. I trust independent facts and not politics. I believe both parties are right and wrong sometimes. Only my wife is right all of the time. Anyways, while I'm not passionate about either political party, I am passionate, as you know, about our country. And I was thrilled that a record number of people voted. No matter how you personally feel about the result of that election, I'm thrilled so many voted when so many have sacrificed so much for us to have that right. The number of votes President Trump received was over 74 million, which would have been a new record, except the president-elect Biden received 7 million more at over 81 million. Again, I'm simply saying I'm so thankful so many people did vote, because I don't take that right for granted when so many have sacrificed so much so we could be free to vote. One of the big problems we faced in 2020 was that it was a year of great racial strife and division. All we can hope for is that progress can slowly but steadily be made to fight racism and its symbols. I'm personally thankful for the vast majority of police officers who served us and kept us safe in 2020. You may have seen on the news recently about the bomb and about how police officers were rushing in and doing everything to save people. I can praise them while simultaneously condemning the actions of the officers we saw this past year who clearly treated black people unjustly. We have to find ways to balance the equally true facts that most police officers are good people, while those who are not need to be removed and punished when necessary. Both those things can be true. Just like peaceful protests are fine, but violent and destructive protests are not, those things can both be true also. But the heightened awareness that 2020 brought to race relations allowed for some important symbolic changes to take place in 2020. For example, NASA named its headquarters in D.C. after Mary W. Jackson, the agency's first African-American female engineer. And as a side note, I highly recommend the movie Hidden Figures if you haven't seen it. The nation is finally recognizing how hurtful symbols of the Confederacy are to our black brothers and sisters, as these symbols represent people who fought against the United States to continue slavery. As examples, the state of Mississippi replaced their flag in 2020 because it contained Confederate symbolism. Fairfax County renamed Robert E. Lee High School after the late civil rights leader John Lewis. Congress voted to rename 10 installations that had honored Confederate generals. And NASCAR banned the Confederate flag from being displayed at its events. Change and progress concerning racism may come slowly, but when we eliminate symbols of that racism instead of proudly displaying them, we are making progress. Progress was made in 2020 simply by having heightened awareness and seeing some of these symbols done away with. And that's a silver lining in the midst of all the terrible things we saw happen related to race this year. Of course, the biggest problem in 2020 has been the virus. 1.7 million people, last I read, have died worldwide. More people die each day here in the United States than in the 9/11 tower attack. Millions have lost their jobs, and many businesses have struggled. But the biggest news of hope is something you all know, that the whole world worked together to share information to find a vaccine. Before 2020, no vaccine had ever been developed, trialed, and approved in under 4 years. It was done in 2020 in a matter of months, twice already. But it's so important that research was shared around the globe to help make that happen. Hopefully the vaccines will help us finally turn the page on COVID. Another silver lining is that millions and millions of people do listen to the scientists and medical professionals who ask them to wear masks and distance, which has certainly helped to slow the spread. I'm also thankful that people recognize how essential people like truck drivers and grocery store workers and other professions are to all of us, how we all depend upon each other, how everyone's job and what they contribute to society matters. We especially got a chance to be even more grateful for healthcare workers and teachers and so many others. Do you know the biggest thing I'm thankful for about the virus? As bad as this virus has been, I thank God the mortality rate is low. I know so many people have died, even healthy people, but it could have been much worse. Thank God it wasn't a disease where 10% of everyone who got it died, or even more. Every life lost is tragic, but I'm just so thankful that so many people have had the virus and have come out okay, including many people in our church family. Sometime in 2021, we will get past this, and it will be because people have worked together all around the world to make it happen. Another great example of people coming together from around the world in 2020 to work together is in the global battle against carbon emissions. Carbon emissions fell in 2020 by 7%. It's the largest decrease ever recorded. Of course, they'll rise again some next year after the pandemic is over, but countries around the globe are listening to their scientific experts about how vital this is and are working together on a global scale. Many countries, even China, have pledged to have zero net emissions by mid-century. Many large corporations are doing their part also, With Amazon pledging net zero emissions by 2030, and even Walmart by 2040. Even leaders of fossil fuel industries are calling out for change, and many major financial institutions in America divested from coal and other fossil fuels in 2020. 2020 was the first year since the Industrial Revolution that more coal plants closed than opened. And praise God, it's not about politics. If it were about politics, nothing would ever change. It's about the free market, a Republican ideal, the free market. It's simply that solar and wind power are now both significantly cheaper than coal, making it possible for countries like China that use a lot of coal to divest from coal and switch over to solar and wind. The free market is also working in automobiles. In 2020, 10% of all new cars sold around the globe were electric, a 28% increase over 2019. As the price falls, that number will only increase. Again, a free market response. Many countries are taking action also. Many countries have looked at the horrible wildfires destroying forests in places like Australia and California and are working to try to reforest the earth. In India, for example, 2 million people planted 250 million trees in one weekend in 2020. England has planted so many trees, it hasn't had so many trees since the time of Robin Hood. Perhaps most importantly, 14 nations that own 40% of the world's coastline just banded together to create the world's biggest ocean sustainability initiative. Their combined effort means combined areas of ocean, roughly the size of Africa, will become sanctuaries dedicated to restoring fish populations and reefs while eliminating plastic. All of this is a global problem, and in 2020, people and nations around the world have worked together in many ways to fight it. Another thing I'm thankful for in 2020 has been the stock market. Not that I own stock personally, I don't, but my pension is invested in it, and probably so is yours. No matter how you personally feel about President Trump or some of the leaders he assembled, the stock market rebounded incredibly from the hit it took from the pandemic. That indicates many major businesses are doing well despite the pandemic, and that's crucial because businesses, not the government, create jobs, and we need jobs created. Again, I know how some people feel about the president, but when you look at facts, it can't be argued that in 2019, before the pandemic, the economy was strong with unemployment at all-time lows. So I know many people have lost jobs in 2020. Jobs are slowly being created again, and the health of the stock market, combined with hopefully the eventual end of the pandemic with vaccines, has economists predicting a gradual recovery until we're hopefully at 2019 levels again. So I'm hopeful, and I think the job the president and his economic team has done keeping the stock market strong helps give me that hope. And although I'm personally a deficit hawk, and I know the deficit is at all-time highs, I believe the time the government should borrow money is when a stimulus is needed. So I'm also hopeful somehow Republicans and Democrats and the president can somehow come up with a COVID relief plan or a stimulus plan that can actually help people who need help most and businesses struggling the most without all the pork. Hey, I'm an optimist, and I'm looking for silver linings today, so I'm praying for it. Another thing I've been thankful for in 2020 has been technology. An estimated 3.4% of people worked from home in 2019 before the pandemic. 3.4%. At its high mark this year, that number is 42%. 42% of people were working from home. And in most cases, the sky didn't fall when that happened. Many people might be able to work much more from home moving forward, hopefully shortening commutes and increasing family time. My own family was talking to my sister's family over Zoom on Christmas, and she told us how she and her husband Marcus both work from home now in the same office, where previously they both worked opposite shifts sometimes, with Marcus having a long commute. They haven't seen each other this much in a long time. That same technology allows me to visit virtually and regularly with my father, who lives in a nursing home in Pennsylvania. When the pandemic hit, his nursing home made an effort to get electronic devices into the hands of patients at scheduled times so they could still visit with their families. I haven't seen my father this much in years, even if it's over a computer screen. And it is technology that allows us to still try to provide a weekly worship experience for everyone, like you're experiencing now. Again, even if it's only on your screen at home, I know it's not the same, we can still be connected and worship together. And I'm incredibly thankful for Edmund Rowe and Brandon Barati and Jacob Jones, who come volunteer their time in the tech room every week behind the scenes to make this possible for all of us. And also when it comes to our church, I can't tell you how grateful I am that people are still participating in worship virtually, still supporting our ministries financially, and still finding ways to serve. We haven't had to lay off staff. We have been able to fund our missions to help those in need. There are many churches who have struggled in 2020, not only financially, but just in providing worship or ministries. But our incredible staff members have found ways to keep ministries going. For example, Kayla and Brandon have found creative ways to still do youth ministry and keep our youth connected to each other, the church, and God. Just yesterday morning into this morning, they did a 24-hour movie marathon with all kinds of decorations, and escape rooms and everything, with the youth in masks and spread out throughout the building with safety protocols in place. 45 youth were here last night. They found ways to begin sports ministries to reach out to people despite the pandemic, and they've been doing these types of things despite these conditions for almost a year now. Our incredible staff and our incredible congregation have come through everything that's happened in 2020, still supporting the work that God is doing here in this place and still changing people's lives. I'd like to share one other silver lining for me personally in 2020, besides my church family I just mentioned, and that's my own family. Since my kids reached a certain age, they've been involved in many activities. It's just the way they're wired. And so when they were young, we had family meals all the time, and family togetherness was basically our family DNA. But as they grew and became involved in so much, that became harder and harder to do. And then, of course, Gabrielle and Samuel graduated the past few years, and the whole family was rarely together. Now, please understand, I'm not trying to say the pandemic has not been a horrible thing. It has. But if there's a silver lining for me personally in that sad cloud, it's that I've spent more time with my whole family in 2020 than I have in years. And I know there probably will never be another year again when I'll have so much time with all my kids. So while I'll remember 2020 for the bad things that happened the way everyone else will, I'll also remember that I had more time to spend this year with the people I love the most than I ever will again. Sadly, I know that's not been true for many. Many have been more isolated than ever before this year. I'm just trying to say, for me, when I try to look on the bright side of this year, it's something that for me personally will be true, the amount of time I've been able to have with the ones I love. And now as I close, I'd like to read the scripture for today. It comes from Matthew 8, 1 through 21. In this story, Jesus has already fed a crowd of 5,000 just a short time before this. And now he feeds a crowd of 4,000. Hear these words. During those days, another large crowd gathered. Since they had nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples to him and said, "I have compassion for these people. They've already been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. If I send them home hungry, they will collapse on the way because some of them have come a long distance." His disciples answered, "But where in this remote place can anyone get enough bread to feed them?" "How many loaves do you have?" Jesus asked. "Seven," they replied. He told the crowd to sit down on the ground. When he had taken the 7 loaves and given thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples to distribute to the people, and they did so. They had a few small fish as well. He gave thanks for them and told the disciples to distribute them. The people ate and were satisfied. Afterward, the disciples picked up 7 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. About 4,000 were present. After he had sent them away, he got into the boat with his disciples and went to the region of Dalmanutha. The Pharisee came and began to question Jesus. To test him, they asked him for a sign from heaven. He sighed deeply and said, "Why does this generation ask for a sign? Truly, I tell you, no sign will be given to it." Then he left them, got back into the boat, and crossed to the other side. The use of the Pharisees and the disciples had forgotten to bring bread except for one loaf they had with them in the boat. Be careful, Jesus warned them. Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod. They discussed this with one another and said, "It is because we have no bread." Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked them, "Why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see, and ears but fail to hear?" Those words that Jesus says often in the New Testament. Do you have eyes but fail to see, and ears but fail to hear? And don't you remember when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many baskets of pieces did you pick up? 12, they replied. When I broke the 7 loaves for the 4,000, how many baskets of pieces did you pick up? They answered, 7. He said to them, "Do you still not understand?" Friends, Jesus said in this story what he says often. People have eyes to see and ears to hear, but they still don't understand. The bread that Jesus multiplies and gives to a great crowd represents that God gives us what we need, our daily bread. God blesses us each day. And there are so many blessings for so many, for all people, that there are still baskets left to fill. In other words, those blessings God gives us overflow. Our cups runneth over. 2020 has been a hard year, but if you have eyes to see, you'll see that God has still blessed you, still blessed all of us in 2020. It's easy to focus on all the bad things that have happened this year. Don't forget, don't overlook the good things, the silver linings. Have eyes to see the blessings God has given you this year. One final personal story. In 2020, our family dog died after 15 years, which doesn't begin to compare to the grief of losing a family member, I know, but was still sad for our family. Because of allergies in our family, I was looking for some time for a hypoallergenic dog we could rescue. But although many dogs need rescued, hypoallergenic ones are hard to find. I finally came across a puppy who was 7 months old, who had never been adopted, who had only been around other dogs and the woman who was the breeder, and in short, hadn't been loved. So we adopted this puppy, and here is its picture. It's the first one, Jacob. Thank you. This is Wicket. It's Wicket because if you know anything about Star Wars, if you're a Star Wars fan, the Ewok, he looks like an Ewok, and the main Ewok is Wicket, so the kids named him Wicket. This dog is a Shih Tzu and supposed to be very loving, but not having been around people, it was shy at our house and avoiding the men especially. When we took Wicket to the vet said how unusual it was for this breed to be like this and thought it would help Wicket if we got another puppy. So we talked about that, and then we went to find another puppy, not trying to rescue one this time, but just find another puppy. And when we did, it turned out the puppy we found online had a twin that he was wrestling with and playing with when we visited. And they were so incredibly adorable together, we decided not to separate them. And we took both of those new puppies home. And they're named Peanut and Butter. There's a picture of Samuel with Peanut and Butter. One is darker and one is cream-colored, so they're Peanut and Butter. And I think there's a few other pictures there, Jacob. Did you get others too? There's Peanut on top of a big dog. And there's Butter on Christian's lap. So yes, we go from having no dogs to having 3. And when Christian graduates this summer and goes off to college, Elizabeth will still have 3 siblings at home, 3 puppies. 2020 ends for the Darren family with cute puppies. Our cup, our house in this case, runneth over with kids and puppies right now. But really, our house overflows with blessings from God. And I know it. And even as hard as 2020 has been, believe me, I have eyes to see how much God has blessed me. And I hope you do too. I understand you're probably looking forward to 2021, but my heart is filled with joy even in 2020 because God blesses our lives to overflowing, enough to fill up extra baskets of blessings every day. And God does the same in your life also. Your blessings in 2020 are not going to be the same as mine. If you look back on this past year, the things that you would have are different than mine. But God has blessed us all. God has blessed us all. Even in the hardest of years, God is with us and blesses us, our cups to overflowing, our baskets to overflowing every day. So let's end this year, 2020, with a song of joy. And let us have joy in our hearts always. Here's Firmly Grounded, closing our time of worship with a wonderful song of joy. Together next week virtually again. It will be a new year. The calendar will have turned, but many things will still not have changed. The virus will still be there. People will still be sick and contracting it. There will be people who still don't have jobs. There will be people who are still in need of us, praying for them as they battle illnesses. In some ways, some things will be exactly the same as the calendar changes to 2021. But you know, will also be the same as the calendar changes. God will still bless us every day. God will still fill the baskets to overflowing. Our cups will runneth over with blessings. Don't lose sight of all the blessings when you look at all the problems around us. remember you're blessed every day. And so let your heart still be filled with joy, and let that joy flow out into this world that needs it so much right now as this new year begins. And as you do so, may the blessings of God the Father Almighty, Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord and Savior, and the peace and unity of the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you forevermore. Amen.